Welcome back to the Blues Society of Northwest Florida's weekly podcast. This week, I'm really excited to have with me Slim Richardson. Basically, without him, we wouldn't have the Monday Night Blues Jams. So I know that nobody's going to be able to hear it, but let's go ahead and give a round of applause to him. Clap at your computer if you can. Welcome, Slim Richardson. How you doing?
Doing great. Good to be here with you.
Well, thank you so much for doing it. Well, let's start off, Slim, a little bit. How the Blues Society kind of got back on its feet when you came back to Pensacola. We'll get into your history in a little bit, but I kind of want to get into the history of the Blues Society and the blues jams that we know on Monday nights. How to get started and why'd you start it?
Well, I actually had a little trio at the time, more of an acoustic thing,
right.
And we got called in to do a thing at the Belmont Arts Center. It was a girl, I believe her name was Teresa, that was doing a thing down on Thursday nights, and she had an act canceled.
Mm.
And when we walked in, we did pretty much original type acoustic blues. And the people in the Belmonts asked me about if I would be interested in starting up a weekly blues thing. And I said, yeah, they wanted to start right away. And I said, no, we need to sit down and talk. And we talked about what we wanted to do and what we wanted to accomplish. So I originally started it out at the Belmont Arts Center. Their mm-hmm. first night was May 17th. 2004.
Wow. So was there just not much of a blues scene here? Was it just the Blues Society kind of dwindled down to nothing? What happened?
Well, my take on things, when I came back to Pensacola, I was just amazed that everything had dropped off, really, as far as the musical thing going, especially the blues. This used to be a major stop on the Chitlin' Circuit.
Interesting.
You had people that stayed down here, like James Brown, Otis Redding, people like that. And there wasn't anything happening that way anymore. And I always tell people that I'm not so smart that I think I can. It's just that I'm too dumb to think that I can.
Okay.
I said, well, I want to do something blues here. And that's how the whole thing rolled about. And we have kept it blues for 10 years. It's been the longest running jam of any sort in the history of Pensacola.
Well, you've got to be proud of that, Slim, and it's going
Absolutely.
Fantastic. And just as a midpoint here, just to make sure anybody who doesn't know about the Blues Jams, it's every Monday night, Lily Marlane's at Seville Quarter gets cranking about 7 o'clock with a solo and 8 o'clock with the band and 9 o'clock with the Jammers, just to give a little background. All
right.
Well, now, speaking of background, Slim, let's get a little background on you, how you started playing harmonica, because I've heard you play harmonica. You're fantastic.
Thank you.
And I just want to kind of get into your background about how you got started, how you got into the blues, and who your influences are.
Okay. My mother, I have to tell a little bit of a story here. My mother was a multi-instrumentalist.
Mm-hmm.
And she was one time known as Tiny the Carolina Girl, and she did more of the country blues. I mean, I was yodeling mm-hmm. by the time I was 5 years old.
Okay.
And both of my parents ended up in the ministry, and one of my mother's biggest influences, so I heard a lot of this growing up, was Mahalia Jackson.
Okay.
And as she never really recorded any blues per se.
Right.
But I mean, the lyrics she had, you know, one of the songs that comes to mind is Trouble. And it starts off, Trouble just seems to come my way.
Right.
And that kind of led me to look into other things as I got older. I had an older brother and sister that I got a lot of the contemporary music that was coming along, you know, with Elvis and Roy Orbison and all those things. So I was always into music. I've always loved it. And I later discovered people like Mance Lipscomb, Mississippi Fred MacDowell,
yeah.
Blind Lemon Jefferson. And I listened to this music. And even though that along the mid-60s and later 60s, we were seeing some basically white bands playing the blues, I never really saw anybody that could play blues and sing it with the same feel that I saw when I first heard Johnny Winter.
Oh, man, yeah.
It was kind of a funny thing because we were at a big festival, and I was with a buddy of mine over at the concession stand. I heard this band playing, and I said, wow, I didn't know they were going to have any black guys here playing.
Interesting. Right.
And So we made it up to the stage and only saw these three white guys. And I said, well, you know, the guy that I heard singing must have stepped off stage or something. I was there helping with sound.
Sure.
And
sure.
All of a sudden, Johnny Winter starts singing his thing, and they were doing Mean Mistreater. I'm just standing there with my mouth open. And I told this buddy of mine, I said, you know, I can do that.
Yeah.
He said, you're crazy. And I said, no, seriously. And 2 weeks later, I'd started my first band.
Nice.
In the late 60s and early 70s, pretty much what I did was just basically sang. And, you know, bands were fairly large at that time, 6-7-piece bands.
Sure, sure.
And we were doing a lot of the more psychedelic-type things. And, you know, the guitar solos were 10, 15 minutes long. I'd go off the stage, go to the bathroom, have a drink, talk to some people, come back, and I'm still standing there. So I picked up a harmonica and started just doing something, not look stupid on the stage.
Nice.
And I started listening to different harmonica players at that time. I was trying to figure out what they were doing, people like George Harmonica Smith and Big Walter and stuff, and started refining a little bit more. And probably the most influential to me on harmonica was James Cotton.
Okay.
We had that thing of disco music coming.
Yeah.
And this really ruined a lot of things for live band. And, you know, I wanted to be a useful person in a band because, I mean, if you were just a singer, bands were having to cut down because, you know, we went from making $200, $300 a piece to making $300 for the band.
Right.
So I listened to what James Cotton, and he does a lot of background, kind of replaces where organs and rhythm guitars and
sure,
stuff
sure.
go. And that's really how I developed my style with that.
Well, then tell me what took you, you know, around. I mean, you're obviously getting bigger and, you know, the band was doing better because you moved away from Pensacola and you were playing around. Tell me about the life on the road. Was it something that you liked? Was it something that you wanted?
There's two things with me. There's a saying that I have. It's about the music.
Okay.
Now, the other thing is about the way that people receive your music.
Mm-hmm.
That makes a lot of the things worthwhile that you do. Because I'm going to tell you, there was a point in my life that we'd been out on the road for like about 6 weeks.
Right.
And I'm laying in a bed. It's in a friend's house because I didn't have a house.
Right.
And all I had to drive was an equipment truck that we basically lived on on the road. And I began to think at that point, you know, I'm better off staying local. So I was in Atlanta at that time. And that's basically what I did. I got a day gig, and I started playing at night. And I have been playing now for semi-professionally, I guess we'd call it, for 45 years.
Sure. Well,
go ahead.
Well, let me ask you this about the band that you play with. Is there something about the band that you really like to have with you? I mean, are you a guy who likes it to be a huge band with, like, the organ, brass, and all that? Or do you like kind of a smaller, more intimate, like maybe just guitar, bass, and drums, and then you playing harmonica and singing?
Well, the latter is usually what ends up happening.
Sure.
Unless you're on something really major, especially in the blues genre, you can't hardly support a big band anymore.
Right.
And as long as they're tight, and there's one thing that I always tell the musicians that work with me, is that you have a license to create.
Right.
And, you know, we don't talk about, well, that's not the way it is on the record.
Right.
You know, I do what I do. It'd be pretty hard for me to play some of the songs that I started out playing 45 years ago exactly the same way. They've grown, the arrangements have grown.
Sure.
And in my writing, because I have a very eclectic taste in music, my writing, I believe, brings an influence from all of that.
Well, that actually brings me to my final question, and one I've been lax in asking people the past few podcasts, but I want to make sure I get back on track with you,
okay.
Is about the nature of the blues, because a lot of people see the blues as something that's stuck in time, whether they want it to be Chicago electric blues or whether they want it to be Delta blues or some sort of Eric Clapton-ish rock blues. Do you think that blues should be this one thing, or can it incorporate all these influences, and can you have rock, metal, jazz, blues, and all these different kind of influences in there and still call it blues?
I absolutely do think that. And I'll tell you a little conversation I had with Willie Dixon.
Okay.
A friend kind of set me up to this, and we went walking into this house. There's this big glass sitting over in the corner. And he looked at me and he says, "I hear you got yourself a band, and you be playing blues, and people be telling you, it ain't no blues." And I'm like, "What?" And he started laughing. He said, "How you doing? I'm Willie Dixon." And
nice.
We sat down and we talked. And he told me, he said, "You know, when we first started electrifying blues, so we had people coming up because all they had heard was people like Lead Belly and
right.
Blind Lemon and these kind of things where they're doing acoustic." Now, Lead Belly had a thing he did better because he was playing a 12-string.
Right.
He said, "But they would tell us, that ain't no blues." He said, and we were talking, and I said, "Well, you know, I feel like music has to grow.
Yeah.
If it's not growing, it's dying."
Yeah.
So, yeah, all of these things can be developed into blues. Now, if you want to sit down and do just a straight acoustic blues, that's fine. It's great music. I love it. And I do things like that myself. But I'll take it to the max. When you put me with a band, we'll take it absolutely to the max that it can be taken to.
I love it. Slim Richardson, a phenomenal harp player. If you haven't gotten to hear him play, if you haven't gotten to hear his band play, you've been missing out. I hope that at some point we're going to get to see your full band be playing at the Blues Jams. Pensacola is better off with you. Thank you for coming back and helping get those Blues Jams started.
You're quite welcome. My pleasure.
Well, Slim, thank you so much for the interview as well. I look forward to getting to play with you again sometime. I think I played with you a couple times at the Blues Jams, and it's always a pleasure.